I'm going to spend just a few minutes on yellow cake itself, simply because it's a very, very simple story. There's not to cover. I think the really interesting story is the uranium market and the nuclear sector of the power generation market. Firstly, just on yellow cake, we own physical uranium, as Sarah mentioned. I'll go through the balance sheet in the next slide. We have a buy and hold strategy. We don't trade our uranium because we've created a vehicle for investors to take a view on the underlying uranium commodity. And if I traded my physical holdings, I'd maybe be trading against my shareholders. As Sarah mentioned, we only have physical uranium. We don't do exploration. We don't process. We don't mine. We have our physical uranium stored in two locations. There are only three locations in the West where you can store physical uranium. It's one in the US, one in Canada, and one in France. We store most of our uranium in Canada and some of our uranium in France, so stored in safe jurisdictions. We have a long-term contract with Kazatomprom, which is the world's largest and lowest cost producer of uranium. That contract allows us to buy up to $100 million of uranium at the spot price. The spot market is very thin, very tight, so being able to buy that sort of size of uranium without moving the market is very advantageous, we think. We have a low-cost structure. We only have two full-time employees, myself and a CFO. We both work from home. We don't have a full-time office. We've outsourced our IT and accounting, bookkeeping, and some of the uranium transactional activities. We target a cost base of less than 1% of our net asset value. Currently, we're running at about 0.7%. So if you think about that as a management fee, it's not a management fee because it encompasses all our costs. That sort of the cost base or the leakage of the structure. Just going to our balance sheet, we own almost 19 million pounds of uranium. The spot uranium price is $50 a pound. So you can see that translates into $940 million of uranium, and we have about $13 million of cash. That's it. There's no debt, there's no hedging. It's a very, very simple structure, and it's all equity financed. So you know, our net asset value is £4.37 a share, and our share price today was a little under £4. So we're trading just slightly below our net asset value. Just quickly, on a corporate summary basis, we IPO'd in 2018 in July. We raised $200 million. Our market cap, as Sarah mentioned, £700 million. Not that long ago, it was $1 billion, so it's been a good ride for us. You can see certainly since the middle of last year, the uranium price has really taken off, and with that, our share price. Just quickly on our share register, I know I'm talking tonight mostly to retail investors, and the retail investor component of our register is very important and significant. When we IPO'd in 2018, we didn't do a retail offering. But today, we've got over 30% of our register is retail. In terms of geographic distribution, we're slightly under half North American owned, just under 30% UK, and then the rest of the world. So the North American component is a very important part of our register. It wasn't that way when we IPO'd. It was only about a third at the time of the IPO. But our recent raises have been very, very strongly supported by the North Americans. US and Canada, and they understand uranium and they understand the nuclear market. The uranium story continues to strengthen, and I think it really took a major turn mid last year. Two factors. The Sprott Uranium Physical Trust came into being and started buying significant amounts of uranium. They've raised over $2 billion to buy uranium. But more importantly, I think, here in August last year, the wind didn't blow, and we saw what happened to wholesale energy prices. Wind is a significant proportion of the UK's energy generation mix, and also in Europe. So we saw the wholesale energy price go up significantly, and I think people then started to appreciate the importance of base load 24/7 reliable power, which nuclear provides. On the back of that, and you know, really since the Biden administration came into being and put the U.S. back into the Paris Agreement, we've seen more and more countries adopt green goals. I think something like 76 countries have adopted carbon neutral goals. The high cost of constructing energy infrastructure has meant that those countries that have nuclear fleets are putting more efforts in maintaining those nuclear fleets. In the US, we've seen life extensions from 60 to 80 years, and now talk about life extensions beyond 80 years. Japan is talking about extending their reactors beyond 60-year lives. So, you know, it's an important fleet or important source of energy in the world that we live in today, where we face an energy crisis. Post the Russian invasion of Ukraine, which I'll cover in a few slides, there's been a real focus on energy security and energy diversity. And again, you know, nuclear has benefited from that. You can store nuclear fuel very easily. If you think about a jelly bean of nuclear fuel is equivalent to a ton of coal. So it's very energy dense, it's easy to store, and you can store, you know, many, many years of that energy safely. We've seen the market go from oversupply when we IPO'd in 2018 to undersupply. So today, or for this year, the forecasts are for around 130 million pounds of primary production against around 175 million pounds of consumption through reactor burn. So we're in a deficit market. Inventories have been drawing down over the last few years, so it's a very, very tight situation. And, you know, against that, a lot of companies are looking to bring on new capacity, but they're facing constrained supply chains, labor markets impacted by COVID, and capital inflation. Just quickly on the demand story, when we IPO'd, we took a view that nuclear was underappreciated. It was a very simple thesis. Supply, demand, nuclear was underappreciated. I think now we've seen quite a major pivot towards the West in terms of nuclear. So previously, it was all about China and the growth of the reactor fleet in China. Now, we are seeing, you know, the US protecting its existing fleet and talking about new reactors. I don't think they'll be big reactors. They'll probably be small reactors. But France is now talking about 6 new reactors. The UK is talking about new reactors. So we've seen that reinvigoration of nuclear in the West when everyone assumed that the reactor base there would decline. And against that, China has stepped up its desire to build nuclear reactors. You know, this year, 5 new reactors commence construction, and they're looking at building 6 to 8 a year. They want to take their current capacity of 55 gigawatts to 75 gigawatts by 2025 and 110 gigawatts by 2030. So significant growth there. Just quickly on the Russia-Ukraine conflict and what impact it has had on the nuclear market. The USSR or Russia has supplied the US in terms of enriched fuel since 1980 and Europe since 1975. If you look back over the last 10 years, on average, about 20% of the enriched fuel that's going into the US comes from Russia, and in Europe, it's 33%. So very, very significant contributions to the uranium's fuel cycle in those two regions. And, you know, for that reason, nuclear has been specifically excluded from all sanctions. So there is no sanctions on nuclear fuel coming from Russia or being transported across Russia. But what we are seeing is a lot of companies are migrating away from Russian supply. So existing contracts are being honored, and people will take deliveries under existing contracts, but we think there's basically been a pause on contracting for new supply. And we're starting to see a deglobalization of the fuel chain. So previously, you know, where there was a lot of contracting with Russia, we're now seeing Western utilities scrambling to find non-Russian sources of enrichment and conversion. And, you know, the West can build conversion and enrichment facilities, but it's going to take time. The technology exists, it's an industrial process, but it could take up to 5 years to build new enrichment capacity. So, you know, what happens between now and then is the very, very interesting question. And just quickly to touch on Russia's role in conversion and enrichment. So the miners mine the raw uranium. It gets converted into a uranium oxide, which is what we hold. The oxide then gets converted into a gas, which is UF6, so that's a conversion process. The UF6 then gets enriched, which essentially is stripping off the 238 isotope and maintaining the 235 isotope. It then gets reconverted into solid, into fuel rods and fuel bundles. In conversion, Russia has got something like 30% capacity, and in enrichment, it is 45% of global capacity. So you can see how significant Russia's role is in those two components. And, you know, what has happened, if you look at the spot prices for enrichment and conversion since the invasion of the Ukraine, they've gone up significantly. You know, conversion has gone from $5 to $25. It's now just touched $40. And the enrichment price has gone from $50 to $80, and now we're talking about $135. So this is the Western utilities scrambling to find sources of non-Russian conversion and enrichment. We saw the utilities look at the front end of the contracting market, which is the U308. But post the Russian invasion, they really paused on that front and switched to try and find these other sources. We think they've done what they can do, and we are now starting to see the utilities go back to the uranium concentrate market. And to this slide, so if you look back over the past years, on average, utilities contracted for about 73 million pounds. This year, so far, we've already seen 106 million pounds put on a contract, and you know, we could see quite a bit above that. So it'll be really an all-time high in contracting, which you know, it shows you that the supply and demand balance is such that utilities are now starting to worry about supply. They've whittled down their inventories and now do need new supply in the face of growing demand. Talked about the contracting that has happened, but if you look forward to the end of the decade, there is still a significant amount of unfulfilled contracting requirements. So particularly towards the mid and end of the decade, the utilities still need to contract for future needs. Now, again, just going back to the fuel cycle, to go from the mined uranium all the way into a fuel bundle that goes into your reactor, that's an 18-month to 24-month process. So if you're thinking about, you know, your uranium needs in 2026, you really need to start purchasing that uranium in 2024. So, you know, it's fine to think about the requirements back end of this decade, but utilities really need to think about that contracting today, and we've seen that pick up. Just quickly on the supply side, you know, when you talk about most commodities, you talk about copper, you talk about demand, and you talk about China. In this commodity, I think it's much more of a supply side story. The demand growth when we IPO'd was 1 to 1.5% forecast. Today, it's more like 3 to 3.5% per annum growth. So a significant jump on the demand side. The problem is supply. Four countries produce 75% of the world's uranium. Five companies produce over half of the world's mined uranium. And Kazakhstan, you know, accounts for over 40% of mined uranium globally. And it borders Russia. Just putting the supply and demand together, we can see that further out, we're going to have a shortage of supply. And the green bars represent forecast production. Now, anyone who's been in the mining industry knows how difficult miners, the time they have to try and produce or bring projects online on time, on budget, on schedule, it's very, very hard. So those green bars, you know, if that production doesn't come on stream as it's forecast to, we are going to see supply-side shortages. So just in summary, I know I've gone through this pretty quickly, but I'll leave a lot more time for questions. You know, we're seeing a big shift in the demand side for uranium and the acceptance of nuclear. At this last COP27, for the first time, nuclear had a proper seat at the table. You know, it didn't face the ideological challenges it has recently. So we're seeing green ambitions, but more recently with the Russian invasion, energy security has become a very, very important feature. And against that backdrop, you know, yellow cake is a very, very simple structure. It's low cost. We only hold physical uranium. We do a few other commercial things. We've looked at royalties and streams, but haven't done any. And we've done location swaps. Sometimes we can swap material between the Canadian facility and the French facility because there's a price arbitrage. And we've done that in the past. But also, we're a very liquid investment. We trade about 1 million shares per day. So at a £4 share price, you can see that's a little under $5 million of trading a day. There's some days we've traded up to £7 million. So, you know, simple, low cost, and a liquid investment opportunity. So, Sarah, I'll pause there and we can go to questions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I just want to get some more information about that contract that you have with Kazatomprom. It runs till 2027.
That's correct.
And then I'm just wondering, what happens after 2027? How flexible are they with their contract? Or are you going to face, as a company, a supply crunch after 2027? How would you mitigate that?
It's a good question. So when we put this in place in 2018, it was a 10-year framework agreement, which was the first year was the initial purchase and then 9 years of option. You know, we could talk to Kazatomprom and extend the contract. It's something we'd love to do. But it really depends on the state of the market at that time. You know, it may not suit Kazatomprom. If we weren't able to extend that contract, we'd be in no worse position than the spot uranium price. So we could still go and buy uranium in the spot market. But what happens is you know, because the market's quite tight, if we were to buy, you know, £1 million, I think we'd move the price $5. So we'll have to do smaller raises more frequently. You know, that would be the worst case outcome for us. And last year, we bought £9 million of uranium. £6 million came from Kazatomprom, and we bought £3 million in the spot market. So we have done it in the past. We have been able to you know, buy spot material. But what we'd like to do is anchor a raise around Kazatomprom. So we'd raise the $100 million. We'd know what price we were getting from Kazatomprom before we went out and did the raise. We'd raise $30 or $40 million more, and we'd opportunistically use that in the spot market. That's kind of been our strategy in the past. But, you know, worst case is that we would have to go and buy in the spot market.
Any questions from out there? Have a think about some questions to ask Andre, because he's very good in terms of the whole holistic market. Now, what would happen if a utility came and said, we want to buy all your inventory? What would you say?
Well, ultimately, that's a decision for the shareholders. You know, given it's a simple structure, I said we've got two employment contracts. We don't have an office lease. If there was a supply crunch, and I think that's a real possibility. You know, if we get to the mid this decade, I think there's a real possibility there could be a supply crunch. And if a utility was short material, they could bid for the company. You know, if they wanted to pay a 20 or 30% premium, we take that to the shareholders, and the shareholders could decide, you know, whether that's something they wanted to do. So ultimately, I think the shareholders will determine the future of this country company. When we IPO'd, you know, we took the view that uranium was a commodity. Commodities are cyclical. We were close to the bottom of the cycle. But at some point, you're going to get to the top of the cycle. So, you know, what then? I think at the top of the cycle, we may trade at a big discount to net asset value, and our shareholders will probably say, you know, what are you going to do about it? So I think, you know, a utility coming bidding for the company because they can get access to the inventory is, you know, it's a feasible proposition.
So you've mentioned deglobalization, accelerated in part by Russia's invasion of Ukraine. So I'm just wondering, what uncertainty are you seeing in the industry due to that invasion in terms of the bankers, the bankrollers, the enrichers, the utilities and the investors?
Wow. I'll start with the investor side. I think, you know, it's been a really, really tough year from a macro perspective. You know, anyone with an equity portfolio would tell you that. And yet, you know, we're still up for the year. The commodity's up for the year. So it's kind of been, you know, good for us. But the macro environment has meant that we've traded at a discount to net asset value for pretty much the whole year. Last year, we were at a premium to net asset value. And what we'd like to do is when we were at a premium to net asset value, we issue stock and buy uranium. Last year, we raised almost $400 million in three separate raises. This year, we haven't been able to because of that discount to net asset value. So, yes, you know, the fundamentals for our industry are good, but I think the macro environment is weighing on it. You know, I'm an optimist, and I think that next year it's hard to see that we could have another year like we've had this year in the equity market. So we've seen contracting pick up. There were a couple of equity raises overnight in the uranium space. Two companies raised money. You know, one was $60 million, one was $30 million. Both well supported. They got them away easily. So I think there is money for you know, niche opportunities. But, you know, we need the macro environment to improve. You know, the Russian invasion of Ukraine, obviously the thing that gets into the news a lot is these missiles flying over and around these nuclear plants. You know, that's a concern. These nuclear plants are fairly modern, and, you know, they've been designed to withstand, you know, the impact of a plane, you know, like the Twin Tower effect. So they are... A missile hitting the reactor is not going to do much damage. The bigger issue is they have ancillary energy. You know, they're connected to the grid, so the grid supplies power to keep the cooling systems running. They've got backup generation, which keeps the cooling systems running. If those cooling systems don't run, you could get a runaway event. So the thing that worries me is that sort of, you know... Chernobyl was a bad example because it's a very, very old reactor and, you know, modern designs are much, much safer. But a Fukushima, you know, it's a one-off event. I think that would be very, very damaging for the nuclear industry.
Any questions from you out there? Or shall I keep going? Because it's turning into the Sarah and Andre show. I'll keep going. So you mentioned equity raises. Let's try and visualize the book building, because you've said that, you know, 30% of the register are retail investors, of which there are many of us in this room. Because I think that one of the first book builds, you only had 25 investors, but it was oversubscribed and you got more money than you needed. And then the subsequent book build, 75 investors. So what is the demographic of the book build? What do you need? Should you need to raise equity again?
I think that, you know, what you've mentioned there really talks to how the nuclear story has evolved through the course of the year. So beginning of last year, nuclear was a very, you know, there were a few people who've done a lot of work and had conviction, and they came into that first book build. By the time we got to the third equity raise, it was a much broader base. We saw a lot more generalists in the raise, smaller ticket sizes. I mean, you know, if you went back 4 or 5 years, you'd probably see one media story a quarter on nuclear and uranium. I mean, now you look at the Sunday Times this weekend, there was a full-page article on uranium by John Yeomans. So it's getting a mention almost every other day or every day. So I think, you know, Reddit and all of these other things, it's become much more widely followed. So I think the demographic of more about how well that the sector was understood and how that evolved. You know, the more times it got into the news, the more people followed it.
Now, for those of you who don't understand how your physical uranium is held, you mentioned the facilities in Canada and France. So if you can explain a little bit more for the uninitiated, you know, how you buy the uranium, we know who from, and how it gets to its destination.
Yeah, so I went to see our uranium last month. So I had to fly up to Blind River in Ontario. It's a very, very secure facility. I was only allowed to take a few pictures outside in the yard, and then I had to have every photograph vetted because it's an offence to even take a picture and carry it across, you know, provincial borders in Canada, let alone outside of the country. So it's a very, very regulated commodity. We are licensed to hold the commodity in those two storage facilities, but not licensed to transport. So I couldn't pitch up there and say, I want my barrel of uranium. When we buy our uranium from Kazatomprom, it's delivered to the facility in Canada. The Canadian facility accepts it. They do a quality check because all the uranium is co-mingled into the next stage of the process. So we don't have barrels of uranium with our name on it. It's a bit like going to NatWest, taking your £10 note, you hand it in, your name's not written on the note, you just get a credit in your account that says you're entitled to £10. So in the same way, we're entitled to barrels of uranium, but they all go through the process. So what happens is Kazatomprom deliver it to the storage facility, it gets quality checked, it gets transferred into their account in their name. They then do a book transfer into our name, and then we pay them. So, you know, we don't have any of the logistics costs or risks. We only pay for the material once it arrives in our name. And just dimensionally, you know, 19 million pounds of uranium against global production annually of 130 million pounds, it's a sizable amount. But that uranium, in terms of size, it's probably half a football field, two stories high. That's it. You know, that's kind of, if you took the total mined uranium annually, it would fit on one coal ship. You know, it's not a big commodity. You could fly uranium. So I think, but, you know, I digress a little from your question. So, you know, it gets delivered by the producer to the facility, gets transferred into our name. If we do a location swap or want to sell it, we book transfer into someone who has an account at that facility. So, you know, I couldn't sell it to you unless you opened that account and went through all the KYC process, which is quite a lot of fun, you know, if you wanted to purchase uranium.
Not even a jelly bean of uranium, which is equal to a ton of coal. I smiled when you said that because, folks, uranium is not candy. You do not eat it. Just put it out there. Be very careful with the metaphors that you use. They're very suggestible, this audience.
Yeah, well, the uranium in those barrels is benign. You know, it's very, very low reactivity. I mean,
so you have tried it then?
It's more reactive to be on a plane than to touch that uranium.
Very good. Andre, thank you very, very, very much indeed. And you brave the weather to make it here. So thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.